Enigma depravatio est. Enigma cuderitas est.
Welcome back, my fellow seekers. I'm Peter from Enigma Seeker, and welcome to my Atlantis in Egypt series, part one. I'm here at a Masonic library, and there's one thing we Catholics and Freemasons like Randall Carlson can agree on, is we have a taste for sacred architecture and mysteries of the Bible, and Atlantis may have a biblical connection. Now, Atlantis has been so romanticized that we fail to look at the legend more rationally. Instead of falling for New Age or racist ideas coming from people like Robert Sepper, or outlandish claims on Atlantis coming from people like Jimmy from Bright Insight. Although I do have to give credit to Jimmy for finally putting Atlantis back in Africa where it belongs. But we shouldn't take it out of the historical and anthropological context of all the archaeological evidence that we do have. We shouldn't put Atlantis in our expectation, but put it in the perspective of the people at the time and fit it more logically to the anthropological record, as well as looking to clues in other legends and stories, such as in the Islamic faith, which could point to clues. But at the same time, we shouldn't take those legends too literal. Just like with Plato, we can't take his account too literal. We have to piece together to what fits most logically and fitting it closely to the anthropological record. But at the same time, we should still be open to challenging the current theory on civilization, as Graham Hancock does. So let's challenge the current popular narrative on Atlantis by presenting a new theory of Atlantis in Egypt.
Even in 1995, the notion of a lost civilization was not a new idea. That notion has been around for a very long time. We can take that notion actually back thousands and thousands of years. The most famous example is Plato, the Greek philosopher Plato, who gave us the story of Atlantis. From Plato comes the story of Atlantis, a great advanced civilization which had navigating and seafaring skills, which could explore the world, which built gigantic buildings, which had advanced knowledge in every area, which was prosperous and powerful. But then Plato says that corruption crept into this society, that it became cruel and avaricious, it became greedy, it began to impose its power around the world. And he has a very ringing phrase. He said that Atlantis ceased to wear its prosperity with moderation. And the suggestion is that it's this hubris, this conceit of Atlantis, that it had become so sure of itself that somehow the universe struck it down, and we have the cataclysm of flood and disaster, and that Atlantis is submerged beneath the waves. Now, of course, the view of historians and academics is that Plato's story is just made up. He just made it up to make some political or philosophical point. But this cannot be so. That view can't be right. I was very suspicious of that view the first time I heard it from a mainstream historian. Why are they saying that Plato made this up? Plato repeatedly states that it is a true story. And I think that we really have to reconsider our attitudes to these stories that have come down to us from the past. Academics have been too quick to dismiss them, too quick to say, oh, we've figured the whole story out, there's no mystery there. Maybe there's a huge mystery there. Maybe we should listen to these clues and hints from the past that speak of a great civilization.
First, let's start with the epistemology of Atlantis for clues. According to the Roman scholar Pliny on the source of the Nile, the land of Ethiopia, spelled with an A, has also been sometimes referred to as Atlantia. But the land of Turkey is known to be called Anatolia, and from the land of Morocco, the mountains there are known to be called Atlas. and even the word Aryans is a derivative for the word Atlanteans. It just so happens that there's a name used at the site of the so-called unfinished pyramid near Giza called Zayat el-Aryan. Aryans refers to a religious title given to either a god or someone of royalty, so hence the pyramid that was to be built here or was taken down. It's not associated to race alone, although it does refer to Persians. And there are other place names that can give us a clue, such as Agartha, presented by Mr. Mythos.
The third possible independent mention of Agartha may actually predate Jacques Collier. In 1871, the French philosopher and theologian Ernest Renan described Asgard, the city of the gods in Norse mythology, as being located in Central Asia. This is not a confirmed reference, but it is definitely strange to read of a utopian land so phonetically and geographically close to that which Jacques Collier described just 2 years later. These three writings of Harji, Jacques Collier, and Renan in tandem are evidence that Agartha itself is not just a Western fantasy, but possibly a myth that goes much further back in the East. And while the oldest myth in this video may very well be that of the island, our next stop comes in second, the legendary hidden city of Shambhala.
And the place name Shambhala, as I pointed out in part 2, has a Persian root, not Indian or Sanskrit. It has been passed down into India through the Indus Valley. And the Persian culture grew out of the influence of the Mesopotamian cultures, and then the Egyptian cultures. Now, I've mentioned this research before in a previous video of mine named Ulf Richter of Schwabenheim, Germany, where he argues that Plato's Atlantis, or the Brahmin Shambhala, was on a river delta, and the delta being Agartha. He goes into detail on why it would be on a river. So logically, we can argue that Atlantis, the island aspect, is the Nile Delta, and the river valley is like an island oasis surrounded by a sea of sand and water. So we do have to cherry pick to what is most logical based on what we know today in archaeology. If you want to believe Atlantis is in Antarctica, this is not the video for you. So, it's a fact that there are only four locations where civilization took hold over 3000 BC. As someone who studied anthropology and landscape architecture, that is where we need to start. If mountains have to be replaced with sand dunes or plateaus, then so be it, because Plato does give us another clue, and that is elephants. And this could be more of an important clue. So that would eliminate China and Mesopotamia. This researcher also shows how Atlantis was most likely a circular city-state, possibly on an island within the river, that was formed like a palace moat system similar to Angkor Wat or even the Forbidden City of China's layout, elevated in moats similar to what Japan's Imperial Palace might have. He also shows that Plato got the units wrong and that he should have been going by the Egyptian state measurement. So the original city-state palace would have been more like the dimensions of the round city of Baghdad, at the very least, which may have actually been inspired by the original legend of the lost round city-state. There was an ancient library in Baghdad, and it's possibly some of those ancient scrolls may have derived from the Library of Alexandria that actually told of a lost city-state. Although instead of 1.2 miles in diameter, Atlantis, the city-state, would have been no larger than 13.5 miles in diameter, that's what he would argue. But more than likely, it was actually probably half that, depending on what you count as part of the city-state, or the outer wall where it may have consisted agricultural spaces reserved for the palace. So if we take a look at ancient palace moat systems, like the round city of Baghdad, this would give us more of a precise idea of Atlantis. I'll leave a link to the article below. Besides Agartha, there's another legend that hints of a lost city-state that was destroyed in Islamic tradition, presented by Mysterious Middle East.
Once upon a time, in the deserts of the Gulf, between the UAE and Saudi Arabia, there existed a city that mysteriously disappeared along with its every inhabitant. Within this lost city, legends say the jinn communed with humans, while religion says real giants call this place home. Today, deep beneath the sands of the empty quarter, this lost city of Iram has now become known as the Atlantis of the Sands, and its reputation is evil. Mentioned in the Holy Quran, due to its practice of idolatry, and even in popular science fictions where the novelist H.P. Lovecraft stated that it is the birth of the place of the cult of Cthulhu, a demonic deity from deep space. Within the Islamic faith, this kingdom is best known for being an ancient metropolis of towering pillars inhabited by a race of giants, who are both intellectually and physically superior to regular humans in every way. But with their power came great arrogance, and with that, the wrath of God and their eventual destruction. In the 21st century, could evidence of this city and its giants still exist? Or is something more alien hidden there and across the Arabian Peninsula? In the 2007 book, Secret Societies, conspiracy theorist Philip Gardner states that occult practices in Iram did take place there and were then put into fictional form in Lovecraft's work. 5 years later, in Bob Kern's Lost Lands, Forgotten Realms, a supposedly non-fictional examination of lost civilizations, he says, "Some traditions say that Iram was built by the jinn themselves, before the time of Adam, and was later inhabited by men. This tradition stems from the name Iram of the Pillars, the ancient Arabic word for pillar, corresponding to another meaning, namely the Old One. The name, therefore, was a city of the Old Ones, that is, the jinn." Historian, geographer, and traveler Al-Mas'ud, in his book Akhbar al-Zaman, even suggested that some early pre-Islamic Arabs believed that the people of Ad were Nephilim-type giants. In 1973, archaeologists at the site of the ancient city of Ilba in Syria uncovered the largest collection of cuneiform tablets assembled till that time. The library discovered in Ilba contained writings that are more than 4,000 years older than all the other tablets combined from other sites across the country. These tablets contain records of all the nations Ilba traded with, including one nation called Iram, a lost legendary city that is today believed to be buried under Rub' al-Khali, otherwise known as the Empty Quarter, an extremely vast stretch of hostile desert spanning the borders of Saudi Arabia, UAE, Oman, and Yemen. These giants who lived in Iram were known as the Arabian tribe of Ad, who while under the rulership of Shaddad bin Ad, were cursed by God. The city goes by several other names, most famously Ubar, and in contemporary fiction, the name of the city. Spoken about several times in the Quran, according to the Islamic traditions, its inhabitants were oversized humans that were large enough to uproot trees with their bare hands, and intelligent enough to build a city composed of large buildings, spires, and pillars that reached to the sky, a technological feat far beyond the rest of Arabia at that time. According to some French historians, Shaddad bin Ad at one time even brutally conquered the entire Arabian Peninsula in addition to Iraq. But probably because of this act, in addition to their idolatry and arrogance, Allah wiped them and their city off the face of the earth, as though they never existed, via a huge sandstorm. Also mentioned in the 1001 Arabian Nights, archaeologists and historians believe that Iram was most likely established around 3000 BC, before being lost in a cataclysmic event. In 1930, the explorer Bertram Thomas was told by local Saudi Bedouin that a once rich, beautiful, but now lost city might be found beneath the sands in an area called Raml al-Shu'ayt. His associate T.E. Lawrence, also known as the Lawrence of Arabia, became interested in the city and famously nicknamed it the Atlantis of the Sands, had devised a plan to search for it himself before dying in an accident in 1935. It was not until 1992, using satellite images, that solid tangible proof for the lost city of giants was found beneath the desert on the edge of Oman. An excavation of the site was headed by the amateur archaeologist Nicholas Clapp, the man who made the initial discovery after studying images captured by NASA. although what he initially found did not equal a sprawling metropolis of ancient buildings. Clapp did find a mysterious fortress that composed of 8 heavy limestone walls, measuring 10 to 12 feet high and about 60 feet long, and 4 immense towers each 10 feet in diameter and 30 feet tall. However, could this really be a remnant of the lost city of Iram? Although Clapp was convinced that this was the city, his critics noted that this archaeological site lacked the scale of the city described in the Quran and local folklore. This was not a city of pillars as described. According to some skeptics, maybe he had found the city that inspired the story of Iram, but not Iram itself. We mentioned earlier that the city also went by the name of Ubar. Some academics believe that this could have actually been an entire separate city from Iram. Therefore, the city Clapp had discovered could have been Ubar and not Iram. Another connection to aliens, or at least a pre-human race of people that may have been giants, can be found in the 14th century book Al-Khitat, written by the Egyptian Arab historian Al-Maqrizi. Here he referred to one scholarly opinion that stated that Egyptians believed that the pyramids themselves had been built by Shaddad bin Ad. Although this was not Al-Maqrizi's opinion himself, this link between ancient Egypt and giants is just one of the many theories that have existed over the last couple of thousand of years.
Now, Muslims tend to take the location of Iram too literal in being Ubar, which was heavily promoted by my favorite archaeologist, Yuri Zarins. This is the guy who desperately wanted Eden to be in Mesopotamia, for which I have debunked. He then goes on to state, "There's a lot of confusion about the word. If you look at the classical texts and Arabic historical sources, Ubar refers to a region and a group of people, not a specific town. People always overlook that. It's very clear on Ptolemy's 2nd century map of the area. It says in big letters, Iobarete, in his text and accompanied in the maps. He's very clear about this. It was only in the late medieval versions of 1000 Arabian Nights in the 14th or 15th century that romanticized Ubar and turned it into a city rather than a region of people." So even he doesn't agree with his logic, but he spent thousands of dollars and years trying to excavate this small little fort stopping point to take credit on it. Because how many archaeologists have actually discovered something? Not many, so when you find something, you're gonna go, oh my god. But he fails to look at the legends more deeply, because he doesn't mention that place names can refer to a group of people and places. Because of cross-pollination of migrational tribes. He fails to mention that there are actually at least 4 place names in Islamic traditions, which are inheriting older legends and fitting it to new lands and adopting it as an allegorical lesson, just as Plato did. One such place name is the legend of Saba, presented by Merciful Servant.
What do we know about Saba? Let us begin our journey for today. And by Allah, dear brothers and sisters, for those who are patient and those who are grateful, you will realize that this story is a life-changing one. Allah said, certainly there was a sign in the homeland for the people of Saba. Allah said, we gave them 2 huge gardens, 2 meadows, one to the right and one to the left. All they would see is green landscape. All they would breathe is the freshest and purest of air. All they would drink is the purest of water. And all what they experienced during their travels was safety and security. It was a completely sterile, disease-free environment. The trees were so dense. Rivers were gushing through these 2 gardens of the people of Saba. This was Saba. And they had a dam. They had a dam that was built, holding that back the water and accessing it as they wished. And therefore, they were hardly reliant upon rainwater at all. Allah said it was baldatun tayyiba, a pure land, a beautiful land. 2 gardens, one to the right and one to the left. Allah said, quran zahira, We had placed cities as stations. So when they were traveling from Asham to Yemen and Yemen to Asham, they would walk out of their home, dear brothers and sisters, without any luggage. No rucksacks, no packing. They didn't need to. They would leave their home and enter a city, eat and drink and rest, and then enter another city, eat and drink and rest, till they arrive at Asham, and they would do the same thing back. Quran Zahira, Allah said. Visible cities that could be seen. I hear you ask, what about navigation? Did they need maps? Did they know the way? Allah said, وَقَدَّرْنَا فِيهَا السَّيْرِ. And we had made the distances from city to city measured and well known. They did not get confused. Allah gave them so much. Just show gratitude to Allah and be patient and resist haram. And they did that for some time, but then they began to change. They got a little bit comfortable. In fact, they got too comfortable. And they began to doubt Allah. And the worship of God Almighty Allah became the worship of the sun. And they began to challenge their messengers. Allah said, فَأَعْرَضُوا. They turned away. They denied my favors. So what was the outcome? فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ. Allah says, I gave permission for the dam to break open, and we sent upon them the flood. The dam collapsed, and torrents of water now were gushing onto their lands, flattening their crops and uprooting their trees and turning sweet fruit so bitter, and turning security and safety into fear and hardship. Everything was destroyed within the blink of an eye because أعرضوا, they turned away. That was the end of the civilization of Saba, and this was when the ten children of Saba, they dispersed into the land. Allah says, ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورِ. We compensated them with this because they were ungrateful, because they disbelieved. And this is how we behave with everybody who is ungrateful, Allah said.
So the legend of Saba, Ad, and Iram are all inspired by Genesis. This is why we can't separate Atlantis and Eden. They are one in the same event and place. Even the legend of Dwarka was most likely inherited these legends, fitting it to their nationality after the Indo-Aryan migration helped establish Mohenjo-Daro by the Yamnaya cultures of Ukraine. But these Aryan cultures are not the original Aryans, for they only go back around 3000 BC. But it's possible their ancestors migrated away from Eden in Egypt some 6000 BC, because according to Greek Orthodox dating on the Septuagint, Genesis takes place around 5509 BC. But I would put this more around 6000 BC or older as the beginning of true civilization, not the age of the earth. So this fits better with the archaeological record. The Yamnaya may not have been the first to domesticate horses, but the first to truly disperse them, for which the Atlanteans failed to do, because they're too confined to the garden. And without horses, you cannot have an advanced civilization, so Atlantis must have had horses, so we need to look for ancient horses in the delta. The Yamnaya may have learned the traditions of domestication from Atlantis, who took brown horses from Turkey, which was dispersed into Ukraine after the fall, or the knowledge was lost and had to be relearned around 3000 BC by the Yamnaya culture. I'm starting to think that we don't need the Younger Dryas impact theory to fit with Atlantis. Another more surgical natural disaster may have happened during the 8.2 kilo year event, marking the end of the African humid period. Because if we take into account Göbekli Tepe some 9000 BC, this would fill in the technological gap of Atlantis, who may have descended from those in southern Turkey. It was only those from Göbekli Tepe who migrated down to the Garden of Eden and warred and then partially unified with the African tribes that Iram was built over a period of 3,000 years according to Islamic legends. So it started around 9000 BC. But then a city-state similar to the size of the round city of Baghdad was destroyed around 6200 BC, possibly by an abnormal monsoon event triggered by an asteroid, that ruptured a dam fitting to the Chinese legend of Gun Yu. This seems far more realistic to me as a landscape architect, and I would argue that the remnants of Atlantis actually still exist, and that may have been at Memphis and Heliopolis, at least when it comes to the recycling stones, possibly up to 20% or more, but that may not be the exact location. If I were to tell archaeologists where to start using ground-penetrating radar to detect original ruins that may not have been completely recycled, I would tell them to look at the island of Al-Hadar. It's possible the island itself is not completely wiped out, but returned to more of a natural state. This island may have been around for thousands of years if it was larger and partially man-made. The Egyptian hieroglyph for city may actually be the original design layout of Atlantis, the city-state. The ruins could lie 30 feet below the surface, but more than likely most of the material has been repurposed throughout the ages, around Cairo especially, if the city-state was about 2 miles in diameter, larger than the round city of Baghdad, which is also 99% gone due to the Mongols. It doesn't diminish Atlantis, but puts it in a reasonable size while still being the most advanced palace city-state of its time, over 3000 BC. Believing Atlantis is the size of London is just ridiculous, unless you're counting the whole Nile Delta plain as a part of it, because Plato does mention the large plain. So we can't put Atlantis in our expectations, but the eyes and the perspective of our ancestors. Atlantis was advanced, as Graham Hancock argues, but we don't need to go all New Agey about this. The size of the city-state reflects the size of the population of the Garden of Eden, aka the Nile Delta region, which was one of the densest population regions on the planet at the time, with over 1 million people going back over 3000 BC. So it just so happens that Egypt has a legend that may match up with Plato's Atlantis, for which YouTuber Archaic Mysteries will explain.
What do we find in Egypt? Are Egyptologists right to dismiss the story as just a literary prop? I don't think so. In fact, outside of a few specialists in Egyptian religion, I doubt many Egyptologists are even aware of how abundant references are in ancient Egyptian culture to the destruction of an Atlantean-like island whose inhabitants the learned ancient Egyptian priests called the Primeval Ones. In Upper Egypt, at the site of Edfu, sits a beautiful Ptolemaic temple dedicated to the god Horus. The reliefs on its walls represent some of the most beautiful art ever developed in Egypt, and its texts are at this very moment being documented and published, but mostly in German. The story these texts tell isn't widely known, but it is of incredible relevance to the story Plato told of Solon's travels in Egypt only 200 years before this temple was constructed. These texts are known as the Edfu building texts, and the sacred inscriptions there tell a story of the first time when the earliest gods of ancient Egypt ruled over an island in the middle of the primordial sea, the center of which housed the most holy of holies, the mansions of the gods, and the sacred Dejed pillar. And this pillar marked the precise location of this island's genesis. Then, without warning, the ancient Egyptians relate that the sound eye fell, and the island was destroyed. Its divine inhabitants were killed. An unknown length of time passed before a younger generation of gods returned to the island of the Primeval Ones and began its reclamation. They renamed it the Island of the Ka, a reference that appears in other ancient Egyptian texts. And these builder gods, among them Re, Thoth, and Horus, reclaim not only the portions of the original island once submerged with the fall of the Sound Eye, but they also had new land surrounding the original sacred island. In the center of that island, they rebuilt the Holy of Holies and replaced the Dejed pillar once found there with a falcon perch associated with Horus, which served as a throne linking the divine to mankind. But again, After an unknown period of time, the reclaimed island also suffered a catastrophic destruction, which is likely alluded to in other Egyptian texts. One of the most well-known stories from ancient Egypt dates to the Middle Kingdom. It tells a story of a sailor who is cast adrift from his sinking ship, but he wakes up on a bed of reeds in the middle of the sea, where he finds all kinds of nourishment and sustenance. Happily, he thrives there until there appears before him a divine serpent who tells him that he will never again be able to return to the island, for it's the mystical island of the Ka, a phantom island that no longer exists. There, the serpent god lives alone, lamenting the loss of his family when, as he relates, a star fell and they went up in flames because of it. Is this a reference to the mysterious sound eye of the Edfu text? Interestingly, this story of the shipwrecked sailor is tied to the destruction of the island of the primeval ones through the ancient Egyptian text called the Destruction of Mankind. In this text, the god Re, ruling as a king during the first time, is anguished with the behavior of man, and after summoning a council of the gods, decides to send his eye upon mankind. This resulted in their near annihilation, and it's recorded that they were slayed wherever they were found, the men and women of the earth hid in mountains and caves of the desert, but the eye found them out, destroying each one utterly. The eye of Re had a very real meaning to the ancient Egyptians. It personified the fierce, destroying heat of the sun's rays. So similarities between the Egyptian stories of their lost island of the gods during the remote period of their first time and Plato's Atlantis are convincing. They both speak of the origin of an island and its original inhabitation by the gods. They relate the geographical appearance of the island, in Plato's case, concentric circles. In the case of the text of Edfu, it's the original island around which is constructed other land by the builder gods. The island in both cases is ruled by twins, 8 pairs of twins in the case of Edfu, 5 in the case of Plato, all divine twins. In the very center of the island, in its most holy of holies, sits a Dejed pillar in the age of the primeval ones, and later the falcon perch, serving as a divine throne uniting the divine to earth and to men. Called by the ancient Egyptian scribal priests, the throne of the gods of the first occasion. In Plato's account, the temple of Poseidon is built on a brilliant pillar of oriculum, on which divine laws are written. In both cases, these divine pillars unite humanity and the divine in a place of central worship at the heart of a primordial island. After the initial destruction of the island in the Edfu text, all that remained of the island was the field of reeds, and Plato describes an impassable sea at the site of the previous destruction. The Edfu texts talk about the fall of the sound eye, which played a direct role in the destruction of the island. What is this sound eye? How did it fall? Plato recorded that Solon heard the story of Atlantis through Egyptian priests in the temple of Sais in the Egyptian Delta. Very little of this temple remains today, and thus we will perhaps never know what sources those priests consulted. But we do have records of nearly identical tales told by the ancient Egyptians themselves of their primordial origin in an island inhabited by sages they called the Most Aged Ones. And it's not unreasonable to conclude that the source of the story told to Solon was the same as that recorded at Edfu, which only now we are translating.
To conclude for part 1, there just so happens to be some mysterious large depressions off the coast of the Garden of Eden that I think needs more attention on. So far, it's believed to be some kind of mud volcano sinkhole or possibly a caldera, for they have found a caldera called the Menes Caldera. Now, this is really only noticeable on USGS maps, and it's a little unusual to see three depressions lined up. But not just one feature, but two features of three depressions. Keep in mind, this was dry land over 6,000 years ago up to the first three depressions. Could these be fragments of an asteroid impact or airburst the size of Tunguska, training in at a shallow angle from the north? I think geologists need to take a closer look at these features and look for more Egyptian glass, and they may have gotten the dates wrong on the Egyptian glass, due to infusion of local sand. Atlantis may not have been destroyed by just one event, but a combination of local major natural disasters, which I will address in part 2, where we will look at other clues pointing to Atlantis in Egypt. This has been Enigma Seeker. Keep seeking those enigmas.
Enigma depravatio.